Good morning, church.
Good morning.
It's good to see you in the house of the Lord this morning. I pray that this week has treated you well. And if it hadn't, well, this is a one-stop place for all your blessings to be sent up to God and for all your prayers to be accepted as well. So whatever you need today, whatever you feel in your heart today, this is the place to share it. We're so glad that you were here today. Let me give you just a couple of brief announcements here. This is the last Sunday of August. That means our time is shifting next week. So the new schedule begins next week. So next week, Sunday school will start at 9:30 in the morning. So 9:30, different classes, wherever you have usually gone, unless you've heard something different from your class, that is where you will go next week at 9:30. The worship service, Sunday school in about 10:15, but I'm guessing about 10:20 to 10:30 is when the worship service will start. So just to give that transition time. So that's the new schedule for the morning. And of course, the evening service will go back to 6 o'clock, and that will be a regular service rather than Sunday school time. So that shift is next week. So if you want to come to Sunday school, be here at 9:30, and the other things will follow immediately thereafter. So saying those things, I also think it's also important for me to say that we should, unfortunately, the COVID numbers are rising again, so we should probably practice a little more social distancing. We should be a little bit more careful how we are with one another. We've talked about this with Connor already this morning, that they're going to try to be more distanced that they can. It's just prudent at this point. It's still going around. It's still affecting a lot of people. A lot of people we need to pray for today because it's really affected. I mean, we don't want to increase that in any way. So just be more careful. Don't gather in the sanctuary groups as much. Outside's better. If you want to wear masks, they're available. Sanitation stations are available as well. So just we just want to keep you safe. I'd prefer not to come see you in the hospital. That's just the bottom line. I prefer you stay well and stay whole. So let's just be as prudent as we can. The Lord has spared us from so much, though people have been affected from outside. But we want to keep that streak going, I guess you could say, and just not be a cause of distress. So just keep that in mind in the days going forward. And prayerfully, this won't be an issue too much longer in the future. But who knows? I mean, none of us know, so we just have to do the best that we can. Okay, that's the two announcements that we have. You want to make that announcement, please?
Good morning.
Good morning.
I want to give you a midway through the year update on our missions for the year. For 2021, our missions to date is $4,630. Our Growing Vine Fund has almost $1,400. That's our church missions fund, yes. And we have only spent $140 out of the Growing Vine because we send $20 a month to the 96 Ministerial Association who helps the people in our community. And our global offering outreach, we want to continue to be thinking about that. They will take that up by December 15th. So if you want to give to the global outreach offering and through the conference, please keep that in mind. And also, if you would do me and Brother Chad, a huge favor, on the back of your tithing envelopes, would you please put who you support and how much you're putting to that missionary? That would help him out a lot when he allocates where your giving is. So if you could please put who you're giving to and the amount on the back of that tithing envelope when you give to missions each week or each month, that would be a big help. Also, I will send out again an updated list on all the missionaries that we currently support. There are a lot in the past that those projects are no longer in place. They've done away with them, so I want to make sure you have that updated list, and I will get that out to you in next month's bulletin. If you want one before next October in that month's bulletin, please ask me, and I will go ahead and get you a paper. I will also try to get it printed July's missions report and put it on the bulletin board at the back this week so that you can see each missionary that we're currently supporting. I'm excited to have Ms. Janine with us today for missions, and I'll be speaking to you a little bit, giving her a little preview of her biography in just a little bit, but it's also almost shoebox time. So go ahead, if you see those back-to-school sales. Some of them are still here going on. Go ahead and grab those pencils and crayons for those shoe boxes, because just in a couple of months, we're going to be packing those up and sending them off to Charlotte. So just want to keep that in mind as we head into the fall of the year. That's one of our most exciting times in missions, I think, is a church. Last year, we had 96 boxes from 96. So I was tickled to death over that. So my goal is always 100. So we almost made it last year. So we'll see if we can get 100 shoe boxes sent in this time. But thank you so much for your prayers and support for missions. God bless.
Thank God for all that's being done and that the work continues. And I'm glad that we as a church can continue to bless the world around us. Our world is hurting more and more, is it not? And I'm glad that we can be part of those who are trying to make it better. Would you please stand as we go to the Lord's presence? Let's just lay our hearts out before Him today. Honesty with God helps Him to be honest with you and to give you exactly what you need today. God, we come before you. Father, there are those that are thankful. They've had a good week, a blessed week. There are those that have come into this house. It's been a difficult week. Strongholds and barriers and bondages, dear God, and they've fought through all week long. There's some that's somewhere in between, and maybe that's the bulk of us. But, oh God, we all come to you, for you are the source of life. And we don't come to you because some of us need you and some really don't. We all need you, Jesus. We need your power. We need your wisdom. We need your goodness. For God, as much as we are involved in, dear God, there's still so many things that we overlook every day that we ought to be thankful for and put our hands to work in. So God, I just ask for your presence to be in this service. I ask you to engage every heart. I ask you to open every eye. I ask you to minister to every soul. For God, we all come with something. Dear God, maybe it's not as much a need as it is a longing, a hunger for you. Your promises are that you meet our needs, you satisfy our hunger, and you bless us and answer us, not just according to what we ask. You do for us better than what we ask. So God, we open ourselves up to you, because God, the greatest work that you can do in this house is the work on our hearts. For God, we need you to transform us and to give us power that when we walk out of these doors, we may be agents of change for the good, for the right, for the things that are of light and not of darkness. So God, we need power, we need strength, and we need courage. So God, I pray that your Holy Spirit will stir us and move us. And dear God, confront us with the world that we may have blinded ourselves to, but we need to engage and do something in Jesus' name. God, this is your time. So dear God, we just open up the service and invite you in. But dear God, we give you center stage. And we say, oh God, you do what you want to do in us. So many have been saying that week after week. They come to the altar. They pray, God, use me. God, work in me. God, do in me in my life. Dear God, that's the type of hunger that we all need, my Father. And I pray we see it again today. And I pray your response will be truly to satisfy our hearts and to lift our eyes to where our help comes from. Dear God, every song, every word, may it be to your glory. Our Lord, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Say praise the Lord. All right, God's good to us. Amen. The scripture talks about let us come into his presence with thanksgiving in our heart. How many of you have something to be thankful for this morning? Go ahead and lift those hands. Let me look at them for a while. Yes, they are right. Come into his presence. Let's sing it this morning.
Yeah.
Bless the Lord. It's good to praise the Lord. It's good to give Him thanks. It's good to engage with His Spirit. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Better to cough a caffeine shot, let me tell you. They got all that stuff in the market that'll boost you up by chemicals and by different minerals, but I'm so glad for the boost that I get by the Spirit of the living God. You want to taste life? I don't know how dry I am until I get a taste of His presence. And then it refreshes me and it gives me strength. I pray the same is for you today. He's come here for you. He says, whosoever will, come and receive the water freely. Come and receive that He has given to us. So blessed be His name. As we go to the Lord in prayer, we acknowledge that we need a lot of Him. A lot of Him in our world. And I pray that we listen to Him. I pray that we truly hear what His words are. God really moved. God really spoke last week. And I've seen throughout this week, God has been true to His word. So if we'll listen to Him, He'll teach us something. You know that?
Yeah.
He'll show us right perspectives and right way to act. It's not like we make the decisions. We need to let Him start making decisions, because we're doing a lot that's not making this world better. But He came to save this world. And that includes me and that includes you, including our needs. I did mention earlier about the rise in cases around us. I don't know too many of us that probably don't know somebody that needs prayer right now, especially in cases of that. I know we have some people that can't come right now because of that. I think in some of our ministers, a lot of our ministers have been hit. Reverend Terry Bailey, I believe, haven't heard a latest update this weekend, but he is slightly better, but he's been on a ventilator, so he's been doing very poorly. So we do need to lift him up in prayer. I know another minister, I don't think he's quite ordained yet, but ideal. He just lost his mother this past week to COVID. So it's very difficult. It's very serious. So we need to pray for these families that God will help them through this stuff, and that this stuff will go away. We don't know why it's here. We know God has a purpose, but I keep being reminded that if God can't wake us up, what's it going to take? If God can't make us serious about our lives and how fragile they are right here, what's going to wake us up? And I'm not saying this is a curse from God, but I will say God used a lot of things to wake Israel up. And when they wouldn't wake up, it only got worse. And the only thing that changed the dynamic was when the people called on the name of the Lord and said, we're ready to change the way things are for the way things need to be. So I do think we do need to pray for our country and our world. I'm reminded of our world. At least we're not being confined to our homes. And if we're vaccinated, we get an extra hour of daylight during the day. If we were Australian, that would be our reward. We get an extra hour of daylight, playtime outside. And I'm thinking, this is the Western world? When did we turn into the prison colony? Well, it used to be a prison colony, but it looks like they're kind of going that way again. All out of fear and all out of trying to, by man, try to handle something that's really beyond their control. So we live in a serious world that needs a lot of needs. And of course, I think about, and we should be thinking about, not only this particular COVID crisis, but the Afghanistan crisis. I know we're concerned about our citizens, but we're leaving Christians behind. We need to understand that. They won't be Americans. They can't come here. But we're leaving Christians behind in a very difficult situation, a life-threatening situation. We're to pray for God to send revival. That the Taliban will be overturned because they believe in a God we don't believe in, and for the Christian God to be Lord over Afghanistan. That's the kind of way we should. Am I wrong? You want to be a missionary? Isn't that what we should be praying? God said pray for the nations, not just God bless America. God bless the world, because that's who He's coming back for. He's coming back for the world. So let's do be praying for that situation. Whenever it comes to your mind, see something on the news, you probably won't hear about that. Pray for them. They're just as saved as you are. They're putting their life on the line with their faith. And so we ought to lift them up in prayer. Do you have spoken needs that you would like to mention today?
Stand together. Praise God. Thank you, Holy Father. Thank you, Holy Father. We'll sing about the cross this morning. Those who can stand, let's worship the Lord. Sing on that chorus.
Time.
she sings, missionaries is going to be here tonight. They'll lead on the piano. I'm blessed. But she's got a great song for us. Let's worship together.
Some of the guys helped me out by passing out little prayer cards. And in there you can find more information, but I'll just take a few minutes just to share a little bit about that. As Ms. Leah shared, I grew up as a missionary kid. I grew up in the country of Kenya, and it was just an amazing childhood. It's one of those things people always ask me, what was it like in Kenya? But to me that was just, you know, what the world was like, because I moved there when I was a year old. My parents packed me up on a plane and took me over to Kenya, and I lived there until I came to college. But I kind of carried this calling of my own to serve in missions. From a young age, probably about 10 years old, I really started feeling the Lord draw me towards that. And it was kind of what I always wanted to do. You know, different people want to be doctors or ballerinas or astronauts or whatever when they're a kid, but I just kind of knew that missions was what I was going to be involved in. And it's been a journey to get to the place where I am, and I'll share a little bit about that in a minute. But where I'm headed right now, I'm going to the country of Wales. I'll be serving primarily in Wales, but also in Northwest Europe. I'll get to work in local church ministry, working with women's ministry and youth ministry, but also getting to work with the worship team. That's something that I'm very passionate about. I love worship. Thank you so much for worship this morning. It was so beautiful. It just touched my spirit. I so enjoyed that. But I'll be involved in working in worship ministry and building up worship teams that not only can serve our local church, but they can also go around and help serve local churches that don't have the resources to have their own worship teams or something like that. So we can help build up different communities and churches in those areas as well. I will get to work in coffee house ministries. If you're not familiar with what that means, I also, a couple years ago, wasn't familiar, but my first assignment in missions was in Hungary. And when I was there, I got to help start and run a coffee house ministry. And it's really incredible to see the way the Lord can use that kind of place. Coffee house ministries were established to help create kind of a safe place to build relationship with the community. Maybe somebody will come into a coffee shop that wouldn't feel comfortable maybe going into a church or something like that. You can build relationship with people kind of in a neutral space, I guess. And I really saw how the Lord used that place, our coffee shop in Hungary, to help establish that kind of relationship, the way that the Lord would bring people in, high school students, community people, just to come in. They were just coming to get a cup of coffee or tea, but it grew into relationships. We got to teach them and disciple them and just see the Lord work in their lives. And so I'm excited to be a part of that again and get to just see how the Lord is going to use that space and just anoint that place for his kingdom. And another final thing I'll talk about is getting to work in rehabilitation centers. As Ms. Leah said, my bachelor's degree was in psychology, and I'm currently pursuing my master's degree in crisis and trauma counseling. And it's something I just feel really passionate about. I'm so thankful and excited for the opportunity to get to walk alongside these people as they pursue freedom. I think it's a brave thing, and I think it's a needed thing, and it's a necessary thing. And I count it an honor to get to walk alongside them, to get to serve them and disciple them and just pour into their lives as we walk through that journey together. And I'm just so thankful for the opportunity. The Lord has allowed me and invited me to do this with him. So kind of moving on from there a little bit, well, before I do that, let me just step back and say, all of those things that I've said, all the different things that I already know I'll be involved in, and things that I don't have any idea yet that I'll be involved in, all of them are to help people meet Jesus. That is the goal, that is the heart, that is the desire, it's to help people meet Jesus. I really just resonated with Ms. Leah was praying this morning. My heart breaks. It breaks that there are so many people that don't know him. And I think about in Afghanistan right now, as Pastor was talking about this morning, that there are Christians left behind, but there are also so many people who don't know him yet that are losing their lives, who are living in fear. And I hate that, and it breaks my heart. And I want to do everything that I can to help lower the number of people who don't know him. I want people to experience him and to understand the joy and the freedom that comes with walking with him. And so that is why I want to go. That's why I'm so excited and thankful and expectant for what the Lord has for the country of Wales and the people that I'll get to work with. And I'm just excited to be a part of it. And I'm thankful for people who pray, people who come alongside me and support me in whatever way to help me do that, because I know that we're all kingdom workers. We're all serving the kingdom in whatever way the Lord asks us to do. And that's such a beautiful thing, and it's such an exciting thing for me. So, shifting a little bit this morning, kind of into the message, when I was praying a lot about this morning, I kind of thought I had a direction where I was going. You're going to hear me say this a lot today. I made a plan. I love to plan, but the Lord oftentimes, I feel like he just likes to kind of tease me sometimes because I'll make a plan and then he's like, you thought so, but we're doing something else. So I kind of made a plan of where I was going, and kind of towards the end of the week, the Lord was like, I don't think, that's not what I'm going to talk about. And I really felt him bring me towards this, and I kind of wrestled with him about it a little bit because it's not one of those like exciting, like, yay, we're talking about this. But I really just felt it impressed upon my heart that I'm supposed to talk about this today. So I'm just praying that the Lord will use this to speak to you and to minister to you. So just kind of backing up in my life in this journey in missions, and I'm not going to go through all the details of it because it's a long story, but as I said, I felt like the Lord kind of put this burden and this draw in my heart for missions at a young age, and because I felt the call so young, I kind of got impatient. I was 18, which sounds, it's quite young, but, you know, when I felt it at 10 years old, 18, it felt like forever. And I was like, okay, God, when is it going to happen? When am I going to know? And then, you know, I'm in college, and I still don't know. And I began to make my own plan. My plan again. Made my plan. I was like, all right, God, well, I know we're doing missions, so I'm just going to make a plan about what we're going to do. And I kind of orchestrated and designed this whole way it would look. And the Lord, in his grace and his mercy, kind of sat me down and was like, that's not what we're doing. And even through difficulty and through difficult conversations and through a lot of humbling things, the Lord kind of shifted everything in my life. The plan that I had made, you know, I knew the straight direction that I was going in, and he said, actually, we're going to go this way, and we're going to take this curve, and we're going to do this and this. And I wasn't always great at listening, and I wasn't always like the most gracious listener. But I'm so thankful that the Lord is patient and he is kind and he is merciful to walk with us through those times of being stubborn and hard-headed and those things. But through the many, many seasons and things that got me to the place, in 2017, I moved to the country of Hungary and I served there for 2.5 years, working in youth ministry and doing different things. I helped establish a coffee house ministry. I taught English. I did kids' VBSs and preached at different places all over. And all of these things are things that I said I would never do. I was like, well, that's not my thing, God. You know, I'll do this and, you know, I'll sing and I'll do this, but I'm not going to preach and I'm not going to teach. And, you know, my mom always told us to be careful what you tell God you're not going to do, because it's like an open invitation for him to like ask you to do it. And that it's true, and it's one of those things, and I say this all the time, that I'm so thankful that the Lord's plans are not my plans, because his plans are so much greater than our plans. They go far above anything that I could ever imagine, and they put me in places that might make me uncomfortable. They put us in places that might make us uncomfortable at times, but it's to grow us, and it's to teach us, and it's to make us and mold us into the people that he has created us to be. So after my time in Hungary came to an end, I came back to the States in December of 2019, and I was approved in January of 2020, February of 2020, to go as a missionary to Wales. And then in March of 2020, the whole world shut down as we all walked through. And I was just at a loss, as I'm sure every one of us. We could all stand up and tell different stories about what 2020, what that meant for us, what the different things that we walked through and the struggles that we faced. And it was definitely an interesting time for me, because my whole job was based on being able to go to churches and meet with people and fundraise, and then getting to leave the country, and then churches closed, and then borders were closed. And I've said, Lord, what do I do? What do I do? And it really brought me to this place of just, if I can just be honest and vulnerable, I was questioning a lot of things, I was doubting a lot of things, and just really unsure of what was going to happen and what I could do to, you know, I felt like I was failing because I couldn't get there and I couldn't fundraise, and I was like, Lord, what do I do? How do I do this? And really began to make me question a lot of like, well, who am I if I'm not a missionary, God? Who, you know, what can I do if I'm not doing this thing that, you know, we've always planned for me to do? And the Lord, again, in His great mercy and grace, just began to teach me really a lot about what it truly means to walk with Him, and specifically what it truly means to walk in surrender to Him. And that's what we're going to talk about today. And I know surrender isn't everybody's favorite topic because it can kind of feel heavy sometimes. But before we even get into it, surrender is a process, and it's something that we're going to get into that. But it leads to a life of freedom. It leads to a life of joy unspeakable. It leads to a place where you don't have to worry, where you're not walking in stress and worry and anxiety or fear, but you can lean back in something, lean back in the arms of the Lord and just rest in who He is. But getting there sometimes can be a little bit of a journey. And that's what we're going to talk about today. So this idea of surrender, you know, I felt like, you know, I thought that I had a pretty good understanding of it. You know, I was like, okay, Lord, life in ministry, I'm surrendered. I get it, you know. But through this time, the Lord has really begun to show me kind of the holes in my surrender, kind of the places where I would surrender if we were doing this, or I was surrendered if this door was what we were walking through. But when those doors were all closed and I didn't know, my surrender became a little bit thin. It became a little bit fragile, I guess. And the Lord just began to teach me about this, about what biblical surrender looks like, and a willingness to actually truly give up control to Him and just follow what He says, no matter how difficult, no matter how confusing, no matter what, but to truly just give up control. And I feel like the biblical idea of surrender is something that we don't talk about it enough, like true biblical surrender. We talk about surrender, we sing about surrender. Most modern day worship songs mention the idea or the word of surrender at least one time. We sing about it on the radio, and I'm not at all faulting that at all, because I think it's a powerful thing, and it's something that it's important to sing out and sing over ourselves. But I think that we can kind of lessen what surrender really is. We kind of make it feel easy, make it feel simple or something like that. But if surrender were easy, then surrender would be cheap. We take the value of it away and we make it seem like it's just some easy little fix. And again, I don't want this to sound really heavy and dark, like I'm trying to be all gloomy on us today. I don't mean that. But this is something that it's just burdened my heart so much, and it's something that I'm walking in right now. As much as I've walked in it the past year and a half, I'm still in this moment walking through understanding this and trying to even go deeper in my understanding of it. But I don't believe that surrender is just this place that we arrive at. It's not just one day, okay, Lord, I've reached surrender. But it's this process. It's something that we walk in for our entire lives. Once we're in this walk with Him, this journey with Him, surrender is something that we are growing in. We are walking in it. We are in the process at all times. And over the past year and a half, the Lord has had me one specific story in the Bible. I've studied other things. I've, you know, obviously read other things in the Bible in the past year and a half, but this one story, I come back to it almost weekly, if not more than that. And it's a story in Genesis 22. And it's the story of when God asks Abraham to sacrifice Isaac. Again, I'm not trying to be dark, but this story is the one that God just keeps bringing me back to. I'm sure that we're all, you know, we're all familiar, but just to recap, Abraham and Sarah didn't have any children, and they were well beyond childbearing years. The Lord sends messengers to them to tell them they're going to have a child. 25 years later, they give birth to their son, their only child, Isaac. And they love Him. He's their pride and joy. And then we come to Genesis 22, and God comes to Abraham and says, Abraham, I want you to sacrifice your son, your only son, the one that you love. And Abraham just does it. Like, he just gets ready to go. We don't hear, like, it's not recorded that Abraham, like, they have a conversation about it. It just says that Abraham gets up and he calls the servants and he begins to make the preparations. They chop the firewood, they pack the donkeys, they begin their journey up the mountain. And him and Isaac are going up, and even as they're going, Isaac asks his dad, Abraham, he says, "We have the fire, we have the wood, but where is the sacrifice?" And Abraham says, "God will provide." And they go up the mountain, and Abraham prepares to sacrifice his son, and then the Lord sends an angel and stays Abraham's hand and provides a sacrifice for the altar. Now, I want to just go on record really quickly and say that I don't believe the Lord has sent me here to tell anybody to sacrifice your children. That's not why I'm here. Just before we go any further, that's not what's happening. As I was looking at this and studying this, and the Lord just kept bringing me back, I immediately was like, "All right, Lord, you're trying to talk to me about my Isaac." And I was like, "What is my Isaac? You know, what is the thing that you're asking me to sacrifice?" And I spent weeks on this, just like praying and trying to think through things and, you know, different things in my life. I'm like, "All right, Lord, I give you missions. I lay that on the altar to you. I give you X, Y, and Z," whatever it was. I just went through different things in my life and just tried to, you know, offer them to the Lord. But I still felt like there was something that I wasn't getting. Like there was something he was trying to say to me that I wasn't understanding. And one day in a conversation with my dad, I was just kind of expressing to him, you know, what I've been studying, and I felt like I was missing it, like there was something in there. And my dad just so simply says, "That story was never about Isaac, it was always about Abraham." Now that may not, like, you know, shatter windows for you, but when he said it to me, it just like clicked something in my heart. And that simple statement, it shifted, because when I was reading it, I was focusing on what was being surrendered, not the person doing the act of surrendering. And after that like realization clicked, my dad said that simple statement. I spent weeks on this, and my dad in one conversation just opens the door. But that simple statement just shifted the way that I was studying this and the way that I was understanding this and even the way that it was affecting me. And so today I'm not gonna take a huge amount of time, but there are three things that I feel like the Lord has brought out to me that I really feel impressed to talk about today, and understanding what biblical surrender is, the surrender that the Lord's requiring of us. And the first thing is that surrender requires sacrifice. In this story with Abraham, it's very obvious to understand what his sacrifice is, that he was willing to give up his only son, his only child. He had waited 100-something years to have a child, and then he had him, and then the Lord said, "Can you give him to me?" It's so easy to understand that and to see where his sacrifice was. And again, I'm not here to tell anybody to sacrifice your children. But there are things, I do believe that the Lord will ask us to sacrifice things in our lives to walk in the surrender with him. It can take on many different forms. I know in my life it's taken on different forms, but it can be plans. Lord, that's the one that I feel like I sacrificed the most, as a plan. Or an idea of what I thought things would look like, an idea of what we thought things would look like. God, I had this mapped out, and this is what I thought we were doing. And even if I've prayed about it and all these things, the Lord can sometimes come and say, "But will you give it to me? Will you give me this dream? Will you give me this desire, this plan that you've made for your life? Will you lay that down on an altar before me and trust me with it?" Or relationships, whether that's a friendship or even a romantic relationship, like that the Lord can come into a situation and say, "Will you give that to me? Will you do the hard thing? Will you walk through that difficult thing and give me something that you've wanted for so long, or something that you cherish so much?" Or it can even be a job. I have a friend that just recently walked through this where the Lord had asked them to walk away from a job that they felt safe and secure in, and the Lord asked them to sacrifice that and to walk away from it, and has brought them into something that they never would have expected to be in. But that process of coming to that place of surrender, of sacrifice, to lay that down, it was difficult. And this is something that we're just gonna be honest about. Sacrifice hurts. It hurts. Sacrifice is dying to yourself, and that is a painful thing. It's not something that we just one day are like, "All right, I love sacrifice." But it's something that you have to hurt through, and you have to make the decision that even though it hurts, even though I can be scared of what's gonna happen on the other side, or what's gonna happen in the absence of that thing, Lord, I trust you enough to sacrifice this, to give this to you. Right. And because it can be painful, my caution is that if we're not careful, it can feel like a punishment. It can feel like, God, why are you punishing me with this? Why are you making me go through this? But that's where that connection to his heart, I'm going to talk about this in a second, but understanding that the Lord does not just do things just to mess with our lives. The Lord is not a God who brings trouble and brings hurt and brings difficulty just because. He is a purposeful God. He is an intentional God, and the Lord uses things in our lives, no matter what it is. I believe he can use anything in our lives to grow us closer to him, to draw us to him, to do something in us or even through us, or to teach us something more about his heart or his character, or to make us into the people he's created us to be in a deeper way. So the first thing is surrender requires sacrifice. The second thing is that surrender requires faith. Now that one might seem a little bit obvious, faith. We wouldn't be in this if it wasn't for faith, but the thing that stuck out to me so much about this is that when Abraham was going up the mountain with Isaac, and Isaac says, "Dad, we have the wood and we have the fire, but where's the sacrifice?" Abraham turns and says, "God will provide." So Abraham called God Jehovah Jireh, his provider, before God had provided in that situation. He said it before it happened, because he knew who God was. And as I've looked at this and just been in this, that to me has been such a crucial thing, because no matter what we walk through, no matter what surrender looks like or feels like, if I know who my God is before I'm there, then none of it can shake me. None of it, for Abraham even, he's going to do what, like, something we could not even imagine. Like, I don't even want to have to think about what that would feel like. But he says, even in that situation, well, my God is a provider, so he's going to provide what we need. And that to me is just such a powerful thing, and it just began to reveal to me that surrender requires faith that is deeply rooted in a relationship with the Lord. It's not a faith that just comes by hearing a sermon once a week at church, or you know, by going to one Bible study a month or something like that. And my young people, I'm going to specifically talk to you right now. It's not a faith that can just be handed to you. It's a faith that you have to take ownership of. You have to take responsibility for it. And I'm not fussing at you. I'm trying to encourage you, because this is something that I wish at a younger age I had been more intentional about. That you take responsibility for your faith. You begin to understand what your relationship with the Lord looks like. You begin to study and hear him and know what his voice sounds like and know who he is. Begin to look at the word and learn, this is who my God is. He is my provider. He is my healer. He is my comforter. But know it for yourself. Don't just wait for someone to tell you. Don't just rely on somebody else's faith, but understand it for yourself. Right. And that can go for all of us, but specifically, I just felt like I wanted to encourage the young people with that today, is that just to be intentional, no matter how old you are, that your faith is yours. It's something that you grow. It's a relationship that you and the Lord have. And it's something that all of us need to push for. No matter if we've been a Christian for 5 minutes or 50 years, we can always learn more about the Lord. Amen. We can always grow closer to the Lord. We can always grow in our relationship and our closeness with the Holy Spirit. And even just learn to hear his voice in different ways and in new ways. And it's something that is so powerful, and it's so necessary to walk this life out with him, to walk a life of surrender with him, because my understanding of him will anchor me no matter what is happening, no matter what I'm walking through, no matter how crazy, you know, 2020 was, or 2021 has been, or 2025 will be, I don't know, you know, but no matter what happens, no matter what season, no matter what is going on, my understanding, my faith in who God is, because I know who he is, will anchor me through all of that. So surrender requires sacrifice. Surrender requires faith. And the third and final thing is that surrender requires a continuous yes. Abraham, he said yes, but Abraham kept saying yes. And this might sound kind of funny to you right now, but I think that it's a little bit of a trap that we can fall into, that we think if we just say yes one time, then that's it. It's just like, all right, God, I surrender this to you. Cool. And then we're just, you know, it's done after that. Like, it's just a one-time conversation. But that's not what it is. And I said before I started that it's a process. It's not just a one-and-done kind of thing. It's not a day that I arrive at surrender and then we're good. I never struggle with it again. I never try to pick up my sacrifice off the altar again. I never question it again. It's not like those things are never going to come. But that continuous yes is so necessary. And I think about Abraham. After the Lord asked him of this, and he began, he gets up. It says in the word that he got up. He went and told his servants to begin preparing. He said he went with his servants and began chopping the wood for the sacrifice, and he prepared the donkey, and he walked up the mountain, and he did, you know, he just kept doing all these things, and each one of those things was a choice to say yes. It wasn't just like he was on autopilot just to go. I think, you know, people in the Bible, they were people, you know, like they were the same as us. They were people. They had, you know, the enemy was still working. He still brought doubt. He still brought questions and fears and all these things, but in each of those steps, I just so clearly see this example of Abraham just saying, yes, God, I will do it. Yes, God, I will do this. And each step along the path was a choice for Abraham to say yes. What if he had said yes, but then he never got up to follow through? What if in our lives, if we've been in situations where we're like, all right, Lord, I will do that for you. But then that's as far as it goes. Just that conversation of saying yes. We don't make the effort to get up. We don't make the effort to start moving. We just say yes, and then wait. Or what if Abraham had gotten up, but then he didn't want to have to prepare the wood or prepare the donkey? How many times in our lives have we said yes, and maybe we've started, and then it got hard, and we had to prepare, we had to do work, and we're like, you know what, this is harder than I thought it would be. I don't think that I want to keep doing this, you know, like I don't think that I'm not going to keep pushing and keep doing this hard work. Or what if Abraham had gotten up, he had made the preparations, but then he chose not to go up the mountain? Or maybe he made it halfway up the mountain and then was like, it's too much, it's too hot, you know, we're in the desert, it's hot, I don't want to go up this anymore. But I think about Abraham. And maybe this is me just adding to it, but I just think that every step that he took up the mountain, he was saying yes. Because walking up a mountain is not an easy thing. Especially this man is over 100 years old, and he's walking up with his son, who he is about to sacrifice to the Lord. So you have to imagine that was the hardest hike that anybody has ever made in their lives. He's walking up this mountain, and he's heavy, because he's about to do something that is so hard. That every step up that mountain was an exercise in surrender. He was saying, yes, Lord, I will do what you've asked me to do. Yes, I will surrender this. Yes, I will surrender this. Yes, I will surrender this. And that's so powerful to me, because every moment, from the moment he got up to the moment the angel stayed his hand, Abraham was saying yes to the Lord. And that just speaks to me just, in mountains of ways. Because even, you know, for me in this season, if I can be honest, you know, God, I said yes to you. We started making plans, and then all the plans went out the window, and now what do I do? You know, there were times when I just wanted to stay home. I didn't want to have to do the work. I didn't want to have to do the things, you know. I'm sure there are times in all of our lives when we can talk about the Lord asked us to do something, or we were on this plan, we were on this path, and then this happened, or this wasn't what I thought it would be, or this broke down in the process. And it hurts, and it aches, and the desire to sit back down, or the desire to say, okay, Lord, we're going to do something else because I can't do this, it's there. And please hear my heart. I'm not in any way today trying to point fingers or fuss, because we're walking in this together. This is something that I am very much so still, and I think forever, will be processing. But this surrender is something the Lord is asking of us, but it's also something the Lord is inviting us into. He's inviting us into this. Abraham had one of the closest relationships with the Lord of anybody in the Bible. And that's incredible. That's, you know, The Bible is full of people who had close relationships with the Lord, but Abraham is one of those guys who had one of the closest relationships with the Lord. He knew him so well. And they walked through things. Abraham went and did incredible things. He was the father of all the nations of the world. And it's just incredible to see how the Lord used that. But it was not cheap to get there. Abraham surrendered. He sacrificed. He walked in faith. And he said yes over and over and over and over again. And I just feel like that's something the Lord is wanting of his church today. It's not something from the past. It's not something that we just talk about in the past tense and look at it in the Bible and say, wow, that's incredible that they did that. But it's the same God that was then that is today. And I believe that the Lord is still seeking surrender from his people, because there are things that he still wants to do on this earth that require sacrifice and surrender from his people.
Yes.
And it's something that we can't be afraid of, we can't shy away from it, but it's something we have to lean into and say, okay, Lord, I don't know what it looks like, and I don't know what the answers are, but I surrender it to you.
Yeah. Yeah.
I surrender it to you, Lord. I surrender it to you.
Yeah.
And the Lord has used this word to convict me, to challenge me, to teach me, and to comfort me over the past year and a half, and I'm sure that this will be one of those things that we're just in it for probably forever. But the bottom line of it is that we have to learn to hear the Lord's voice, to hear him, but then to follow him, to follow what he asks, to follow whatever that is. For me right now, that's following him to go overseas as a missionary. But in 5 years and 10 years and 50 years, that could be something different. You know, it could be whatever it is, whatever he has in his plan that I don't know yet. For any of you, it could be to change jobs or to start witnessing in your community, to start, you know, to my young people to start pursuing a different career, whether that's as a nurse or a teacher or a carpenter or a mechanic or whatever it is the Lord is speaking to you about. Maybe it's about surrendering relationships, surrendering a job, surrendering something. You know what that answer is. You know what that blank represents. But it's about hearing him and following what he's asked. It's about following what he asks. So this morning as I close, I'm going to share a song. You may not know it. You may know it. But it came out maybe in the last 2 years or so. But it's a song that's just simply called Available. And it just is a prayer that to say, Lord, here I am. Take whatever you need from me. Let my life be a sacrifice to you. Let my life be in surrender to you. And as we worship together this morning, I really want to encourage that everyone, all of us, take time this morning to search our hearts, to ask the Lord. Maybe you don't know what the surrender looks like right now. Maybe it's not something that a season you're in right now. Maybe you very much so know, Lord, we're walking through this. You're asking me to do this right now. Or maybe you're somewhere in between those two places. But as we worship together this morning, I just want to encourage you to take time to search your heart and take time to just be honest with the Lord about it. Pray for strength in the surrender. Strength in the surrender. And peace in the surrender, because he is our strength giver and he is our peace giver. Let's just worship this morning and ask the Lord and invite the Lord to come and just minister to all of our hearts today. Broken as my life may be.
just wanna see you
want us to bow our heads for just a moment as we prepare for communion. I can't think of a better way to conclude this message to us all. God changed your plan because we needed what you said today. Thank you. It's ministered to my heart and I know it's ministered to yours. I'm struck. I'm struck by, as we celebrate the Lord's table, how much this deals with exactly what she's talking about. Our Lord came to save us in the last evening before his departure. He gave. He would give at the cross, but at this supper, he wouldn't ask for their bread that represents their body. He wouldn't ask for their wine that represents their blood. He would say, "This is my body, which is broken for you. This is my blood, which is poured out for you." You see, Jesus was surrendered to the will of the Father that we might be saved. So he calls us to the same table, not only to remind us of what he did, but to remind them, this is the cost. We can save no one, but he clearly says, "I ask you to take up your cross, and I ask you to follow me." Ushers, would you please? This is a spiritual time, so right now, as they are preparing to pass out the elements, consider your own heart. Consider your own spiritual well-being. Is all okay? I will definitely remember that God put before me today, what is that Isaac that he wants me to lay down? That thing that I should never want to lay down, but if I love and trust him, I must lay it down. For I must love him more than anything else. Please, please, sir. God bless the elements that we are about to receive. God, I ask that the symbol would impact us, but I ask more that our hearts would be prepared for the spiritual testimony that we are giving right now, that I receive what you have given to me. I receive your salvation, but your salvation cannot be held. It must be released into our lives to live every day for you. So prepare our hearts even as you bless this offering. Under the lighting. We pray, O Father, am I surrendered? Can you ask of me, and will my yes be continual? Every decision from there on, will it be surrendered to you? God, do I trust you that much? Do I allow you to mess up my plans? My programs, my wants, my desires, do I allow you to do that, God? Can you call me? And will I follow? Lord, however I answer that, or however comfortable I am with answering that, shows the condition of my heart and their hearts. So, oh God, I pray that you will show us your salvation. For as has been shared with us, dear God, there is joy on the other side. There is beauty on the other side. There is a favor and a blessing that will go generations beyond us. But we must be willing to say yes now. Abraham said, "The lad and I will go to the Mount Yonder, but we will return." God, I want to believe more in your future than my plans for my future. God, I want you to show us here today because, dear God, you love us all and are calling us all. So, Father, let our hearts not get in the way, but let us say yes. If there's sin in us, God, it's not worth it. Dear Father, let us say, remove it from my life and cleanse that rebellion against you, against your way. Cleanse it from my life, my heart, my wants, my desires. And let me want what you want. Let me follow how you say to lead. And dear God, as I receive the gift of the body and the blood of the Lord Jesus in salvation, and in symbol that I take it seriously, that I am a child of God. So like Jesus, I will be surrendered to you. I will give all that I have to you. Would you please stand as you receive these elements? Everybody been served? If you haven't, please raise your hand. We'll make sure everybody's served before we partake. Nobody's excluded. As long as Jesus is your Savior, this is your supper as well. And I don't know what it means particularly for you, but so often when I see this bread and this juice, I'm reminded that in this symbol God brought me to Him as a young child. Teacher said, you can't take this if you don't know Him. And I said on that day, I want to know Him for myself. I don't even remember the process, but I do know every day of my life that I can recall God's been in my life. He's been there through the good times and through the bad times, through the things I don't understand and the things that I rejoice in. I found Him there with me. And He's been a friend that's stuck closer than any brother, anybody I've ever had in my life. It's real. The surrender must be real too. On the night before He was taken, He took bread and He broke it. For all who want to, break your bread. Because it was not given to them nice, fresh, and untouched. Just like His life was not untouched by our sin, by our wickedness, and by the curse that's upon this planet. And He said, I want you to take and eat of it. And as you do that, do it in remembrance of Me. Thank You for that ordinary life. That was so much more than just ordinary life. You had an appearance that no one would desire You, but Your words and Your life have changed us forever. Thank You. Thank You for Your life. After supper, the Word of God says that He took the cup full of red wine. Not just the end of the Passover, but the new start. We're not going to talk about the past, we're going to talk about the future. And He said, this is the new covenant in My blood. We're making a new agreement today. No more sheep, no more goats. It's Me. I give you Me for all of your life. For all the things that you're proud of, I will bless you. For all the things that you're ashamed of, I will cover you. I give you Me. So He said, as often as you do this, do it remembering Me, that I am Jesus, not Jesus of Galilee. Today, He's Jesus of 96. Because He's here. He's here with us, just as He was with them in that day. So drink all of it, He said. Almighty God, we finally pray that You will touch our hearts. If there's anything unsurrendered there, speak to us in this moment. And we say, God, I surrender. Forgive me for thinking I know better. Forgive me for wanting my way. God, save me from this spiritual cancer inside of me. God, cleanse me and show me what life is. And God, any who pray that prayer should know by the sacrifice of Jesus Christ, the deed is done. Yes. We can leave it.
Yes.
Covered by the blood this day and walk out free. No longer carried, no longer burdened, no longer shackled by it. We're free to live, free to sacrifice. And there will be nothing we ever give that You don't give back to us. And there is not even a loss of life that You will not only give to us, but dear God, You throw in an eternity of bliss in the glory of God forever. God, we never lose anything in our surrender, but we gain everything that truly matters. Bless Your people this day. May we receive You and walk with You. in Jesus' name.